My name is what? My name is
Chicky Slim Spanky.
Hi, my name is who?
Excuse me, can I have the attention of the white trash for 1 second? Hi, listeners. Do you like Imus? Like Francesca knows up his anus like he's some royal highness?
Uh-huh.
I-Man says McEnroe's much more vibrant. Hey, Pinocchio, if Stakey's a dog, then McEnroe's a fire hydrant.
Oy vey!
Broadcasting the show live from the deep south. A tabernacle choir and listening to Imus shoot off his big mouth.
What a schmuck!
Atlanta Live was great, just a matter of time and fate. Fran and Mac directing Envy at stake. Yo, slow down, bitches, don't play a hate.
Hi, my name is who? My name is what? My name is
Chicken Slim Steaky.
Hi, my name is who? My name is what? My name is
Chicken Slim Steaky.
Bo Box says,
Slim Steaky, I may treat you like a kid.
Nuh-uh.
He makes fun of your skinhead. Man, you should bitch slap the three of them. Make their eyes water and skin turn red. Ya hump.
I want to go to Imus's dude ranch. I'd only get lost. You'd tie me to a stump, drop my pants around my ankles, put honey on my balls, and let a raccoon lick it off.
The man's a sadist.
Man, we'd be giving Radio New York the motherfucking fits. Moving through you like X-Lax, giving you the shits. Man, you can't compete with our hilarious comedy bits.
And for the love of God, no more Dixie chicks.
Yeah, they f***ing suck.
Hi, my name is who? My name is what? My name is
Chicken Slim Spanky.
Hi, my name is who? My name is what? My name is
Chicken Slim Spanky.
Hi, my name is who? My name is what? My name is
Chicken Slim Spanky.
Hi, my name is who?
Well, that's pretty good, actually.
Just pretty funny.
Look, did you hear me when I was talking to you
yeah,
to the intercom?
I was back getting something.
Oh, okay, that's fine. I just want to make sure it's still working. Yeah. Oh, that's pretty good.
It is good.
And that's pretty good. That's almost as good as Rob could do.
Yeah.
In fact, why didn't Rob do that? That's a good question, isn't it?
Yeah, you knew that was coming.
Holding the eye, man.
Well, no, we didn't know it was coming, but I just got to thinking about it. What was Rob with the... Why didn't Rob come with the Slim Steaky deal?
Morning,
Leave
Rob.
It up to them. Is that Mike Bell guy?
Yes, sure he's
It's pretty good.
Yeah.
One of the posse there.
Very good.
Over the weekend, some idiot New York Met fan passed out flyers announcing that Friday, June 30th would be John Rocker Day at Shea, and that all fans attending the game would get New York Met batteries to throw at Rocker.
What's that battery that we were selling here that's...
Exide.
Orbital battery?
Orbital battery.
Yeah, let's check those at this guy.
Sponsoring.
Oh, absolutely.
Throw out the first battery.
Absolutely.
At Rocker.
At Rocker.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the morning.
Well, we read in the paper over the weekend about the Russ Salzberg and Steve Summers show...
Hitting the rocks.
...that the show's in trouble.
Wow.
Now, Steve's been working here for how long? 15 years? He goes in and asks, where should I sit?
There's one spot open.
Charles is here, I'm here, well, Warner's there.
Go sit in your car, Steve.
Where do you think you do the show from? Go call in from a deli? Hey, it seems like the markets have been more fickle lately. Stocks are up one day, down the next. So how do you find opportunities in times like these? Well,
we're going to get to them,
so...
Maybe there's someone with a little time on their hands in Atlanta that could do one for me.
Oh.
Apparently, he's got plenty of time on his hands. How about running a radio station, Steak?
Yeah, cha-cha.
Hello?
Hey, Cheese Whiz. That's not a bad idea. It's not Steak coming up with anything. You understand that, Patrick?
Well, of course, we understand. Yeah, that's obvious.
Yeah. Mike Bell or somebody else down there.
Sure.
Sports Talk 790 The Zone, but let them come up with some intros for you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Apparently, Steak has a lot of time on his hands. We'll find out even more about that later in my sportscast, Imus.
Okay.
Imus Sports Report is brought to you by Subaru. Firstly, though, Lakers over the Pacers, 104-87, to take a one-game-to-none lead in the NBA Finals. All Shaq, all the time. The MVP was 21 out of 31 from the floor, scoring 43 points, grabbing 19 boards. Most of Shaq's points came from the paint, as Rick Smits and company were absolutely helpless against the big Aristotle. Is there any way to defend the Shaq? Well, that's precisely what one reporter asked the man himself after the ballgame.
Shaq, throughout the playoffs, a lot of teams have come up with strategies in defending against you, and none of them have worked. How would you defend against yourself?
I wouldn't.
I'll just go home. I would fake an injury or something.
That's a funny kid.
Pretty much sums it up there.
That's a funny guy. I would fake an injury. You sound like Bernard or me or somebody. Very good.
Go home.
I would bring a baseball bat.
I love that.
Maybe he's been listening to the I-Man.
Well, I love this guy.
I have some advice for the Pacers. How about sending Shaq to the free throw line? Only one ominous sign for the Lakers last night was that Shaq was 1-for-6 from the line. How about it, Larry? Tell your boys to hack the Shaq. Now, Reggie Miller has waited his entire career for this moment. Can't be too pleased after last night's Game 1 performance. Reggie was 1-for-16 and scored just 7 points. But the veteran Pacer guard said, don't count me out just yet.
I'll tell you what, if they continue to give me those looks, they're going to be in trouble. Every shot but one felt good. So if they're going to play me like that, it's only a matter of time.
Oh, yo, we're just way over.
I'm a bit scared now.
Shaq's got a fake. Kobe got a fake injuries.
God, really felt good going 1-for-16. Well, felt great.
He should just go home.
And he still talks trash. You got to love that.
Oh, man, unbelievable. Two running his mouth. And he got blown out of this. Oh, man.
Hey, he's 1-for-16.
Yeah, they're going to be in trouble. They keep giving me looks.
Yeah. Man, they should just walk off the court and let you shoot.
One more quarter and we're in it.
Keep them wide open. No, I mean, Mark Jackson was the only bright spot for the Pacers. In just 28 minutes, the veteran point guard scored 18 points and dished out 8 assists. And despite the portentous start for the Pacers, they are 0-for-11 when they lose the first game of a playoff series and 11-0 when they win the first game of a series. Jackson tried to stay positive.
We didn't play good basketball today. We had some great looks. We didn't knock them down. Defensively, we feel we can do a better job on Shaq. But we feel really good about where we are right now.
God, imagine if they lose game 2. It'll feel amazing. Maybe over for John Rocker. The Atlanta Braves reliever has, of course, been demoted to AAA affiliate Richmond.
Good.
Rocker says he may not report. Why? Because he may retire from baseball. The 26-year-old gave an interview to an Atlanta radio station yesterday.
Will you be all right financially if you did that? I mean, what would you do if you quit baseball?
I'd be a stockbroker, probably.
Stockbroker?
Yeah. There's something to be said for, for having a job that is not just, a complete headache.
Now get this, I-Man.
Yeah.
Rocker was interviewed yesterday by the regular guys on WKLS Rock in Atlanta.
Right.
Now I beg the question.
Right.
Where was 790 The Zone,
the all-sports station? The sports authority, the sports leader in Atlanta.
Until about 20 minutes ago, I was wondering what in the world Steak Shapiro could have been doing. And obviously not trying to get an interview with John Rocker, one of the biggest stories, certainly in Atlanta, in the country. Well, now we found out what he's been doing. Coming up with ridiculous bits so we can get more time with the I-Man.
That's a very good point. I mean, why didn't they interview him?
I have no... I said I had no idea, but now I know why.
Get Steak back on the phone, right away. All right. What else, Mac?
Well, Mets won 11-3 over Baltimore. Florida 6-2 over the Red Sox. St. Louis 4-2 over Kansas City. The Yankees beat Montreal 7-2, so the Yanks back in first place. And the Cubs over Arizona 9-4. Sammy Sosa hit his 18th home run, a mammoth 500-foot shot. Big feud going on in Chicago, by the way, I-Man, between Sammy Sosa and first-year manager Don Baylor. Baylor has criticized Sosa for his fielding. Finally, Sammy says, hey, I've had enough.
I play hard every day, no complain. And every time something happens, I am the bad guy. So, that's enough.
Well, here now on the phone, live from Atlanta, is Steak Shapiro. Good morning, Mr. Shapiro, once again. Where were you yesterday when interviewing John Rocker?
Slim Steaky in the house.
No, that's not Steaky.
Enough of that, Steaky.
We got two rock and roll disc jockeys, two Scott Shannon clones in Atlanta getting the biggest sports story of the month.
Sitting on your hands down there.
Where were you?
John Rocker won't speak to us.
What do you mean, don't speak to you? Aren't we Sports Talk 790 The Zone, the sports leader of Atlanta?
Let me explain something to McEnroe.
I can understand why
Never mind McEnroe. Let's explain it to the I-Man.
Yeah, what does it have to do with me, Steak? That's nothing to do with me.
How about you doing your job?
Right. When you get on the air and provide critical analysis of a big redneck buffoon like Rocker, he doesn't sit at your front door like a lapdog to do interviews. So if McEnroe was down here sucking up like he does to everybody else, I'm sure he'd be the first on Rocker's
If we're Sports Talk 790, the Zone, the big sports leader in Atlanta, then we get the guy on the air.
If that's my job. If I run a station,
I mean Francesa criticizes Francesa and Russo murder people. They murdered a Mets manager. Remember that, Charles?
Sure, I do.
They killed him.
Of course I do.
And they still got him on the air.
Absolutely.
Bobby Valentine's name.
Of course, it was a
talk about. You know what it is, Steak? It's being a professional.
Yeah.
Is it, do you know anything about that word, professional?
This
is ugly.
Read my lips. It's called being a crazy trainer.
This is really getting ugly.
Do you hear me?
I hear you. All right.
Why don't you get off the phone and go interview somebody? You're unbelievable.
Go get a story.
You could have had somebody pretend they were John Rocker.
Go do your job, Steak.
Serve the public. My golly.
This is humiliating. I mean, I'm shocked. I legitimately am shocked at this. Aren't you, Bernard?
Very much so.
Absolutely.
Very remiss.
The big story.
This is worse than squealing like a pig on the air.
Charles had it in his newscast,
absolutely,
for God's sake.
Hey, Steak, is that a phone ringing back there? Might be Billy Bob's trailer park calling in to do a spot for the show. Give him a call. Answer that phone.
R-E-S-P-E-C-T. Find out what it means to me. R-E-S-P-E-C-T.
You know, my allergies out here, Charles.
Yeah?
God, they're worse than they are in New York.
I know. I don't get it.
These juniper trees and stuff.
That
Phil? In this page 6 Richard Johnson New York Post item, which married NBA coach is having his fill with the daughter of his team's owner.
Well, if that was true, I-Man, does that mean you're going to change to the Pacers? Would that influence you?
Oh, my God. Don't
That's
even
a thought, right?
He's already thinking about it anyway. Forget it. He already
That would not be good. That is not something I approve of.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter now.
I mean, I think there's no excuse for that.
So maybe you have to put your pick on hold pending the determination of who this guy is.
Yeah. Wait till after the series is over.
Well, why doesn't somebody call Francesa? He's got all. Francesa's an encyclopedia. He knows who the owner of the Lakers is. Bernie, get a hold of Francesa.
Well, it's Jerry Buss.
Oh, Jerry Buss. Well, does he have a daughter?
Yes.
Oh, sure.
Oh, he does?
Yes. Well, what does she look like?
What's her story?
Well, I don't know, but I mean...
Is she a pig boat, or...?
We've narrowed, you know, to point the finger and say, this is the one guy.
We're not saying that.
I mean, you think Francesa is going to name the guy on the air if it's... I mean...
No. Francesa would know whether the owner had a daughter.
He does. Jerry.
How old's the daughter?
I don't know how old she's...
Well,
I
mean, Francesa would know.
She's
Is she married?
Is she married? Well, the article didn't say whether the daughter was married or not.
Is Phil Jackson married?
Well, it says which married coach.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he's married.
Well, no, but that doesn't mean Phil Jackson is married.
Right.
Bernie?
Got it.
Oh. Must have missed that day at Fordham, huh?
No, it's clearly him. Oh. It's clearly him they're talking about.
It's clearly Phil Jackson?
Phil, yeah.
That's come on, Lou. You're just such an anti-Laker weasel.
No. That's the way you read it.
No, that's Chris and Boston who came up with that, not us.
That's the first thing I thought of when you read it.
Read that. Oh, you did?
Yes. Yeah. Phil.
Oh, you did?
I thought that's what you came up with, too, the way
no,
you read
it. No, absolutely not. This is like an alcoholic deal. This is someone right over the eye man's head.
Any idiot could figure that out.
Well, not this one. Warner continues.
Lakers-Pacers game 2 tonight in Los Angeles. Here's the Lakers' Ron Harper commenting on the fact that Reggie Miller said he's mad.
I don't care about him. I don't care if he's mad or not. You know, if he mad, I would be mad, too, so.
That's Ron Harper.
Can we all just get along?
Shut up.
Only three games in the majors last night. Pedro Martinez, 8 innings, 1 hit, struck out 10. The Red Sox beat the Indians 3-0.
I mean, he shouldn't be allowed to pitch.
You know that, should he? Well, setting up that Randy Johnson, Pedro Martinez, 7th game of a World Series.
Oh, man, please.
Oh, man.
Here's the Indians' manager, Charlie Manuel, after the game.
I don't know how long it's been. It's hard for us to score a run. We haven't scored a run in a long time. And you never win unless you score. You got to score a run to win.
That's right. That's pretty good, Charlie.
Got to figure
pretty
it out.
Insightful there.
National League Dodgers beat the Astros 5-2. 10 innings, Mets over the Orioles 8-7. By the way, because this game was a makeup game in New York, the Orioles could not find a hotel in New York after Wednesday night's game.
What?
So they had to fly home to Baltimore and then fly back to New York before last night. Where's the traveling secretary? John Rocker showed up in Toledo last night, joining the Braves AAA Farm Club, where they play the Toledo Mudhens. Said Rocker, "I hate Toledo, and what's a mudhen?" No, he didn't say that.
No, sure?
No. All right, let's hear it for the Jets.
Why?
Tired of seeing NFL draftees charged with crimes and being suspended by the NFL and losing their investment, the Jets have taken steps to protect themselves. You recall wide receiver Lavernius Coles, their third-round pick from Florida State, was suspended last October by Florida State for defrauding a department store. So now, every time Coles is found guilty of a crime or pleads no contest or is suspended by the league, Coles must return $100,000 of his $450,000 signing bonus. Ooh. If Coles is both arrested and suspended by the league, he must return $200,000. At this rate, Coles could owe the Jets money before the season is over. For Imus of the Morning Sports, this is Warner Wolf.
Imus in the morning. Frederick, it's cool for you every day.
Wow, did you read about this, honey?
What's that, dear?
Looks like record-breaking heat again this summer.
Won't matter to us.
Why not?
Look a little further down the page. Frederick is offering rebates of up to $100 during their preseason sale.
So?
Frederick has ultra-quiet bedroom-sized portables and remote-control electronic models. With Frederick Energy Efficiency, we'll save money on our electric bill, plus the largest rebate ever.
I get it. We'll stay cool this summer with a new Frederick air conditioner, right?
You're so smart, dear.
Electronic. And it's simple, with high efficiency. You'll find it's ultra-quiet, durability is free.
Check the yellow pages for your authorized Frederick dealer, look for our ad in the newspaper, or visit us at Frederick.com.
Frederick is cool for you.
I'm Mr. Washington, senior political analyst, the late Richard M. Nixon.
Indeed, indeed. And thank you so much as always, best man in the morning. has she filed for divorce yet? Just kidding, just kidding. The nuptials of Fred Imus and Ms. Lynn Wade. Who covered the event, Dono? The Grain Silo Times Gazette? I can just see the item now. The bride and groom wore matching feed sacks, and tobacco chews were enjoyed by all. I hope I'm not out of line here, but my curiosity is killing me. Do you suppose that Lynn and Fred... Oh, gee, how to put this. Do you suppose the two of them, I mean... Well, you know how you sometimes think about couples, I mean, people like Walter and Joan Mondale doing the deed, and how hideous witnessing that would be? Well, I just have this nightmarish picture of your brother, Fred. Lovely man, no argument, but your brother in the sack with this rockin' blonde who looks like Nicole Kidman or somebody. And, well, it just... makes me sick. Has anybody seen them since the ceremony? Hell, he may never come out. Don't come a-knocking if the trailer is a-rockin', right, Fred? Quite a change for Fred. Gotta stop spitting on the floor. Start putting the toilet lid down. Remember, Fred, yellow in front, brown in back, all that. Well, Dick Nixon wishes them many years of conjugal bliss. I'll bet they're happier today than Bill Gates is, huh? In the wake of the single stupidest judicial decision ever rendered? I won't dwell on this because the breakup order is never going to survive the appeals process. But just let me nutshell it for you. The appeals courts are dominated by free market judges, sane people, who tend to be highly skeptical about government regulation of business, period. And who also tend to think that Judge Thomas Pinhead Jackson, that squiggly Joel Klein and Janet Burnham-Out Reno are all in bed together. And isn't that a lovely image? And are all, well, idiots. My view? I agree with the New York Post assessment, Dono, that the main thing that should be broken up in this matter is Judge Jackson's operating system. I am formally calling for Reginald Dennying the fat bastard and being done with it. Which brings me to Al, I'll never lie to you, Gore.
I may fudge a few things, but hey, gotta get elected. Anyway, the latest with this vermin. On March 15th this year, Gore swears in front of God and everybody that he will not spend any soft money on so-called issue ads unless the Republicans do it first. Well, guess what? I mean, do I even need to go on with this? Sure as hell, the Democratic National Committee, without Republican instigation, has rolled out an ad that shows Mr. Numb himself talking about the prescription drugs issue made by his own media rodents, Bob Schramm and Carter Eskew, featuring his face and crooked teeth, pointing to a website for, quote, the Gore Plan. And the whole damn thing is coordinated by his two top campaign weasels, Tony Three Fingers Coelho and Donna the Ethicist Brazil. Excuse me, if it walks like a duck and squawks like a duck, well, if it ain't Tipper, it's a Gore campaign ad. And in this case, Dono, that's a Gore campaign ad. That is not an issue ad, Toll. Oh, damn it, I'm out of time. I'm not going to get to the story of the New Jersey stripper whose plastic surgeon put breast implants in her butt cheeks. Rats. Or John Rocker on his plans to become a stockbroker. Can't you hear him? Buy, sell, you two-bit disease-bearing mother... You know, he ought to get together with the babe who got the breasts on her butt. They deserve each other. Oh, and by the way, if you're a plastic surgeon, how do you make that mistake? Hey, Doc, when you're treating a stripper, remember, it's T and A, not T on A, okay? Ouch! The view through the old Dick scope today, I do, by strip club aficionado Dick Nixon, a former president of the United States.
Well, a redneck nerd in a bowling shirt was a guzzling Lone Star beer, talking religion and a politics for all the world to hear. They ought to send you back to Russia, boy, or New York City one. You just want to doodle a Christian girl and you kill God's only son.
I'm a super morning.
All right, Dinky.
Who is the Panamanian dictator who's a sex machine to all the chicks? Me. Can you dig it? They say this cat Noriega is a bad mother. Hush your mouth. Well, I'm talking about Noriega. Then we can dig it. Sorry, I'm feeling a little silly today. I'm in a very good mood, despite the fact that a friend of mine was supposed to fly in here with a helicopter to free my ass, and the stupid bastard landed in the wrong Florida lockup and rescued some other inmate. Dumb f***. I'm telling you, it's stuff like that that made the dinosaurs extinct. I'm a big fan of Darwinian theory. You have to be here in the joint. Survival of the fittest is a way of life. You don't keep your head up, your eyes open, and your ass to the wall. You have your eyes down, your ass open, and your head to the wall. I think that's why our new guilty pleasure around here is watching this new CBS show, Survivor. Two teams left on some deserted island, supplied with only what they could carry in their arms, vying for a chance to win $1 million. That is, if they can survive the 39-day ordeal. And the best part is, they're not allowed to just exist. They have to compete in these games of skill. It's the real world meets Gilligan's Island meets the special f***ing Olympics. There's simply nothing better than watching Rudy, the insufferable blowhard who everybody hates, not being able to start a f***ing fire, despite the fact that he's a former Navy SEAL. Except for seeing the old lady Sonia get kicked off the island by her teammates for making them lose the raft-carrying, tribal torch-lighting, idol worship competition. Hey, sorry, Grandma, but there's $1 million on the line here. Take your consolation prize and get the f*** out. Stop whining. You lucky you're not an Eskimo, because a bitch your age would have had her ass stuck on a drifting ice floe 3 years ago. This is the greatest show on television. You can't take your f***ing eyes off this thing. Pampered yuppies having to trap rats to use as bait to catch fish, when you just know the toughest thing they've ever had to deal with in their lives so far is too much foam on a double latte from Starbucks. It's a soap opera with tsetse flies. And actually, if you ask me, it's a perfect metaphorical paradigm for the way you Americans elect your public officials. Like those two hideous-looking guys in New Jersey, Corsain and Florio, that proves the theory known as survival of the richest. And Giuliani, Lazio, and Hillary in New York, that's a whole nother one of Darwin's hypotheses. The one about evolution and monkeys. Jesus, talk about see no evil, hear no evil, and speak no evil.
Teen angel. Teen angel, teen angel.
I'm a sin in the morning.
Blast your office into the 21st century with Ultra DSL. Visit Exario, EXARIO.net. Exario, moving business beyond. I'm Laurie McNichol for the Reuters Fan Highway Patrol.
It's 7 till the hour, and I am Imus in the Morning at the Imus Ranch in New Mexico. Chuck, Bernie, Lou, Warner, all of them are in New York.
Yeah.
And this morning we have posed a question, Warner Wolf.
Yes.
Well, we haven't. We just read it out of Richard Johnson's column, page 6, New York Post. Which married NBA coach having his fill with the daughter of his team's owner? Now, what have we learned most recently, Bernard?
We've learned that the Los Angeles Lakers owner has a daughter who just joined the Lakers as a executive vice president of business operations. She's a very attractive woman. She's not a 16-year-old. She's approximately a 30-year-old woman.
Mm-hmm.
And Phil Jackson is married himself with 5 children.
Right.
And the way the clue is worded, or the that story
Item.
Is worded,
yeah.
There is a clue in that, in the word Phil.
Right.
So therefore, we're deducing. Well, we'll let the people deduce whatever they want.
Yeah. What do you think, Warner?
Well, we have suspended our investigation.
Warner,
well,
wash my hands of this.
Well, we're coming too close. So we eliminated 15 of the teams.
Yeah.
The owners were not married. The owners had no daughter. The coach wasn't married. The owners were too young. Coach was too old. And the coach was just hired.
Yeah.
So we're going to leave it with 14 teams left.
Yeah.
You make the pick.
Well, we're trying to get a hold of Pat O'Brien, Access Hollywood, who you think would know, wouldn't you?
Well, we...
Oh, yeah, no doubt. He knows.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, this is not a witch hunt, right, Aunt Man?
Well, no, it's not a witch hunt.
We don't know if she's a witch or not.
No,
we have no. We're just trying to.
Right.
Then blame it on Richard Johnson. Don't blame
sure.
it on us.
Yeah.
Blame it on the New York Post. I mean, he's the guy who came up with these questions. He asked these questions. These blind items, they call them.
Yeah.
I mean, that's why people read page 6.
Yeah.
Even people don't even read the rest of the paper, which are a lot of them. So now we have the Lakers and the Pacers tonight. Is this a big deal, Warner? So
Game 2. Shaq isn't the only one going strong through the hole on the Lakers.
Well, that will be fine.
Wow.
Now, you're trying to protect these people,
that's
Warner.
Right, absolutely. You're going to cast aspersions on the innocent people.
I'm sorry.
You got 29 teams. One guy out of 29. So all of a sudden, 28 other guys, you know, are under the microscope. That's
well, no, but somebody's porking the owner's daughter. We want to know who it is. That's all. Simple as that. And we got the Kmart 500 this week, this weekend, you know.
Right.
Got the Yankees and Mets this weekend.
And they're lining up in Paris, man.
Shut up.
French Open, men's semis.
Yeah.
Look at those names.
Who's in that?
Juan Carlos Ferraro against Gustavo Cureton.
Yeah.
Franco Scolari against Magnus Norman. Turn your sets off now.
Warner Wolf here, the Imus in the Morning program.
Imus in the Morning.
We don't.
Great. She was great. She has a new album out, and you can
Faith
pick it up.
Faith and Courage, is it called?
Yep, and you can pick it up in stores Tuesday. Roger Ebert has a new book, I Hated This Movie, a collection of reviews of movies he hated. Available at bookstores everywhere. And, of course, Roger's TV show, Roger Ebert and the Movies. And
David Brenner.
Thank you, David Brenner. You can see David perform tonight at Foxwood Casino in Connecticut. Also see David at Trump Plaza in Atlantic City on July 29th. And don't miss Stuttering John appearing in the Donkey Show every Thursday night. For tickets, go to stutteringjohn.com.
The Howard Stern Show.
Rock Radio. K-Rock.
K-Rock.
New music.
Thank you.
Sinatra's history.
Of course, Mr. Sinatra's long dead here.
Well, so what?
Yeah, but still beloved.
God, yes.
And an interesting figure, a mob-related figure.
Yeah.
Tell the I Men about it. And so we thought we'd have the Kuntz brothers on to talk about it.
Now, who are the Kuntz brothers?
Tom Kuntz is a writer for the New York Times.
I got to stop.
Or an editor for the New York Times.
I'm sure.
Phil Kuntz.
I'm positive.
Now, what does Phil Kuntz do?
No. Stop it, though. No. It's got to be Kuntz. It has to be Kuntz.
He's a writer for the Wall Street
Journal.
It can't
be Kuntz. It's got to be Kuntz.
Well, yesterday you had them both working for the New York Times, the Kuntz brothers.
The Kuntz.
What is? So do we have two Kuntz at the New York Times or one Kuntz?
One Kuntz at the New York Times and one Kuntz brother at the...
You're an idiot.
You are an idiot. You both are idiots.
They can come out and talk about it. It's going to be like the vagina dialogue.
There are no Kuntz. There are Kuntz. Do you understand? It's Kuntz. It is Kuntz. It's got to be Kuntz.
No, the book is not a Bush type of book
just
either.
Stop.
Well, no, you're trying serious. Too hard. That's trying too. That's lame and trying too hard.
Oh, they have imagine that.
Yeah, that Bernie, one or two Kuntz.
It's got to be Kuntz.
It can't be Kuntz.
It's got to be Kuntz.
No, this is hard news.
Is it Kuntz or Kuntz?
It's Kuntz.
It is?
It's got to be.
Do you know Bernard?
I've never discussed it with the either one of them. I've spoken to both of them, I just refer to them as...
Well, get one of these cunts on the phone and ask him.
God,
I'm here now, live from Hollywood, California, with our guy, Pat O'Brien.
You're a jackass.
From Access Hollywood, was just as I predicted, by the way, not to patronize O'Brien. But I said it was just a matter of time before they killed Entertainment Tonight, and what they're doing. Good morning, Mr. O'Brien.
You know, sometimes when you know you've made a wrong decision...
Yeah, what's the wrong decision?
I've made the wrong decision to call at this particular time.
My God,
Well, why?
Well, the old man doesn't want to be involved in this conversation.
Well, that's fine. we'll move the conversation to the area in which we're interested.
Well, hold on a minute. Morning, Charles.
Good morning, Pat.
What is that?
Shaq Fu. Game two. It's so nice.
Here's
Glenn
the thing.
Wright.
That'll be fine. Hey, O'Brien.
God.
Well, first of all, congratulations. I'm on a serious note. Congratulations to you and, who's that bimbo you work with? That's very unfortunate.
He's not a bimbo. It's Nancy O'Dell.
You're the bimbo.
You're the Nancy bimbo, okay?
Yeah. Congratulations to everybody at Access Hollywood, because I knew that you guys would eventually, once they... people figured out if they want to find out what Brad Pitt's doing and these other people, they could watch you guys. You guys are great.
Thank you very much.
Now,
Richard Johnson... Remember we sat in your office and discussed this career move?
Yeah. I was against it.
You were very much against it.
Yeah. And now what's that? Now you're Mr. Hollywood.
Trying to be.
Yeah. Now, there's a blind item in Richard Johnson's page six column. New York Post this morning.
And we love Richard Johnson, by the way.
Yeah. Page six, which, by the way, is never on page six.
Yeah, why is that? It's on page like 11 or something, right?
No, it's on a different page every day. But never page six.
Is that why he called, to find out why it's not on page six?
No. He has a blind item suggesting that there is a NBA coach, married NBA coach, who is having his fill with the daughter of the owner of the team.
Right.
And we want to know if you know who it is.
I do not.
Well, because
do you have any information at all?
Do we have any information?
No, beyond that.
Yes, we think it's Phil Jackson.
I know nothing about that item. I can certainly look into it today. It's not the kind of thing we put on our show.
Well, of course it is.
Why would that be?
Well, because it's a big story.
It's a gossip deal.
It's the NBA Finals.
It's called Access Hollywood, not Access NBA.
You had the NBA on TV last night.
I'm glad you're watching.
Well,
you
guys did
Hollywood every day, and then you watch my show religiously.
Then don't try to tell us that you didn't have him on.
No, a big gossip deal.
Don't run jive by deal. Don't run jive
not running
by
any
the I man or the B man or the C man or the L man.
It's not the kind of item we would run.
No, but aren't you interested? You're a big Laker fan.
I'm a huge Laker fan.
It's a big Los Angeles story,
but I'm not sure that's true.
Okay, well, does Jerry Buss
another NBA coach?
Does the owner Jerry Buss have a daughter?
Yes, she does. Jeannie Buss.
What does she do?
She's very involved in the team.
Mm-hmm.
What?
Mm-hmm.
Businesswoman.
Really? Is she married?
I'm not sure if Jeannie's married or not.
Has she ever...
Does she ever do a spread in Playboy?
Look, I do not know the answer to this question.
You don't know whether she was in Playboy or not?
I think she might have been, yes.
Okay, posing with a bunch of basketballs in which your idiotic father thought was neat, or whatever his word was for it.
I refuse to be drawn into this conversation.
No, why?
Because I don't know the answer to it.
Phil Jackson, apparently married with 5 children, is going strong to the hole with the oldest son.
I'd be very surprised if this is Phil Jackson.
Well, so would I, frankly.
Yeah,
well, okay.
So would I.
Yep. Yeah, so would I. I'd be shocked. I'm not to be serious. I would be shocked.
Get ready to be shocked.
Well, now Bernard has sources who he will not even reveal to me, his boss. And I'm not going to force him to, obviously, because he should be able to protect his sources. But his sources tell you what, Bernard?
Well, they're pretty much confirming the story.
Oh, they are.
Although they have no pictures. We don't have 100%. Well, yes, it's confirmed by my sources.
Do I
Bernard,
know
what happened to your hair?
It's gone. Whose hair?
Bernard's.
Well, it's gone.
I cut my hair short.
That is, I'm watching it now. It is hideous.
What's no, it's not. Hair? Bernard is a nice looking young man.
Oh, no, he's
not
a great looking guy.
He's nice and tight, short and tight, brother.
Yeah.
Actually, that's exactly the way my hair would look if I cut it like that.
Yeah.
Because I have no hair either.
Yeah, and you put that tang or whatever the hell you put on.
I don't have 15 people working on my hair before the camera goes on.
It's 17, by the way. I miss in the
morning. Help me start up my .com. Help my business.
He's coming up, Patrick McEnroe. 25 till the hour now.
So, here we are at this convention to remind ourselves where we come from. And to claim the future for ourselves and for our children. Today, our great Democratic Party, which has saved this nation from depression, from fascism, from racism, from corruption, is called upon to do it again.
I see my light from shining from the west out to the east.
And here he is now, PMAC, back. Patrick McEnroe. Good morning, Mr. McEnroe.
Good morning, Mr. Imus. You got me a little startled here. You got me on so early.
Well?
You must be ahead of the game this morning. Well, we are ready.
No, I got some rest, and
this morning. You're feeling good, huh?
Yes, I feel great, Patrick.
This sports report is brought to you by the Hackensack University Medical Center, Imus. And speaking of that, I went out and played at their golf outing yesterday.
How'd that go?
Yeah, went great. Some member was honoring Sean McManus of CBS Sports, the president of CBS Sports. It was a great outing out there. And all the people from Hackensack were obviously talking about the I-Men and all you've done for them. They mentioned your emotional speech that you made and all that.
How are you at playing golf?
I wasn't bad yesterday. Not too bad. I had a couple of decent shots.
Let me ask you this. Are you better at playing golf than, say...
Oh, come on now.
Oh, we don't have to start there.
No, we're not going to start anything. Then, say, soccer.
Oh.
Where did you think I was going?
I just had a couple other things on my mind.
Toward a racket sport, I'm in?
Something about first-round losses. Anyway, big game in the AL Central last night, I'm in. The White Sox sauntered into Jacobs Field in Cleveland in first place for the first time in 6 years. And they showed why with an 8-7 win over the Indians. Home runs for Frank Thomas and Ray Durham. As the White Sox are now 3 games ahead of Cleveland, Travis Fryman of the Indians tried to look at the bright side.
I thought today we played with as much heart as we probably played all year.
With much heart? You lost! You're 3 games behind. Cleveland is not supposed to be losing to the White Sox. Yankees and Red Sox rained out last night at the stadium. Second straight rainout for the Yanks. Of course, the rubber game between the Mets and Yankees was also rained out on Sunday night, and it appears as if the two teams will play a day-night doubleheader on July 8th. The first game would be at Shea Stadium, then shift to Yankee Stadium for the nightcap. Well, get your Metro card and Subway tokens out for that. Atlanta came from behind 8-3 down to beat Pittsburgh 10-8. Braves third baseman Chipper Jones saw his team jump out to a 3-0 lead and thought this one was over. But with Kevin Millwood struggling on the mound, it was not.
We scored three runs with one of our studs on the mound. We expect to roll. And the next thing we know, we're down 5-3 and then 8-3. And, you know, we're just shell-shocked.
Shell-shocked was Kevin Millwood, who continued his slump. He lasted just a third of an inning. St. Louis Cardinals over San Diego 7-3. McGuire hits his 545th career homer. And Steve Young is calling it quits for the San Francisco 49ers. His first NFL game was 15 years ago. His last concussion 9 months ago. The two-time MVP and Super Bowl champ holds the NFL record for rushing TDs by a quarterback. At an emotional press conference yesterday, Young expressed his thanks to what the game of football has meant to him.
I have learned the tough lessons of humility and patience, and I'm grateful for the pressure of football. From when I was a little kid to today, that pressure remained constant.
That sounds fantastic. What a way to make a living. Inspire some young kids to get out there and play football. Game four tomorrow night in Indiana with the Lakers up 2-1 in the NBA Finals. The big question is, of course, will Kobe Bryant, who missed game three with a sprained ankle, be ready to go? Here's Kobe Bryant on his status looking ahead to game four.
You try not to focus on it, you know. I got a nice little stroll anyway, so I'm straight.
I'm all right.
That's right. He's got his stroll working.
Well, let me see if I understand this right. I'm talking through the intercom with my microphone off and it's going out over the air.
Well, there's a speaker that sits back in the corner that is on. Yeah.
It's definitely going out of the studio.
Yeah.
I thought I've done an excellent job of making believe it wasn't happening. I've shown my professional
area. Hey, Charles, how you doing, Charles?
So it's obvious you're really paying attention to me right now.
Okay, well, Charles.
I've had a bad bowel movement, Charles. I'm going to go to the bathroom. You take over, okay?
Charles, you can turn your speaker back on. I just won't talk to you until
There should be some way that when you throw your little switch there, it should mute that speaker. You know what I mean?
Mute what speaker? Yours?
Yeah, or something.
Well, no, they can't do that. You either have to shut it off, or doesn't it still come through your headphones?
Yes, it does.
The only problem is Charles then has to wear his headphones all the time.
Right.
So here's the solution.
Yeah.
Turn the speaker back on.
Yeah.
And I just won't talk to you about anything that we don't want anybody to hear.
Okay, that's good. Or somebody else is speaking.
Or while McEnroe's droning on with his sports thing. So that's probably that's an unfortunate way to describe
that
his
is very
sports
unfortunate.
Report is droning on.
But that's the solution.
Hey, Patrick, do you know about the Ray Lewis deal?
I know that the other two men that were charged got let off.
Yeah, they were acquitted.
They were acquitted, yes.
Both. And Lewis, who reached a plea agreement and apparently testified against him, did he identify them? Bernie, do you know?
Well, what he provided was that he knew that they bought knives the day before the murder. And that was the extent of his incriminating statements against them.
So he's ended up, I imagine, being the only... happened. He's the only one that's been convicted of anything.
Exactly.
That is correct.
Ironically. And plus, he now has positioned himself as a rat.
Mm-hmm.
won't be welcome.
Watch him back, brother.
Yeah, won't be welcome back in that hood.
No. So that's
the only good news is that two murderers were set free in Atlanta, where Steak Shapiro lives. There's a silver lining to this cloud.
Not right, Pat. That is just ugly. God. All right. Anything else, Patrick?
Well, we have a couple more tidbits from this Laker-Indiana series, if you're interested in that.
Sure.
We just heard from Kobe Bryant.
Hey, Charles, let's talk about the fairness, okay?
What's Lazio going to say?
I'm interested in macaroni. What's me and you talk?
All right, come on. Let's go.
Anyway.
I got a great stock tip. I don't want you to tell anyone, okay, Chuck?
Hey, Charles, is the speaker on now?
Yes, it is.
It is on. Okay, well, go ahead, Mac.
Very disconcerting. Anyway, Laker coach Phil Jackson.
And Chuck's okay.
Commenting.
Yeah, he does, I mean.
Hey, you know what I did with my wife last night? Oh, my God. Don't tell anyone.
Come on, you guys.
Oh, boy.
Lordy. 13 till the hour.
And involved a goat.
Dark in the morning, I was sleeping in my cell. I heard a whistle blow. Then I heard somebody yell.
I'm a in the morning.
20
television program, our old friend,
Vernon Jordan.
In a new survey taken by the Screen Actors Guild, it has been revealed that African Americans make up less than 16% of television characters. Although the number is significantly larger than the 13% represented in the U.S. population, I suggest all you old fade cracker pecker world network executives wait a second before y'all start high-fiving each other. Because the majority of the black faces on television aren't in lead or even supporting roles. For the most part, we are little more than set dressing, like furniture, black leather couches upon which the more important white actors put their fat asses. In fact, if it wasn't for Bill Cosby and that belligerent black doctor on ER, you'd be hard-pressed to find any African-American stars. Even if, as you should, count Oprah three times. But look at the prime-time schedule. It's not Joe Frazier on Frazier. It ain't Everybody Loves Ray Lewis. It's Chuck Norris, not Jimmy Walker, Texas Ranger. 66.7% of the CBS shows have at least one African-American. They got two or three on that desert island on that Survivor show alone. And I don't think any of them weenie white people gonna vote them off anytime soon, because if there's anything a black person knows about, it's survival. But ABC, since Urkel left, the only major black character they got over there is the talking cat on Sabrina the Teenage White Bitch. It's bad enough there are no black contestants on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, but why does Regis Philbin have to be the one sitting opposite the hot seat? A black man can't host a game show? Brian Gumbel ain't condescending enough for you? Ain't like Regis was the only Mensa member available. Even with five lifelines, an ask audience, a 50-50, and three phone-a-friends, I don't think he'd be able to get them questions right if he didn't have the damn answers in his hands. Until we can show some kind of ethnic diversity or some real consequence on our television screens, the role of African-Americans in real life will remain that of token extras and props. If the medium is the message, and the medium shows African-Americans as insignificant, then the message sent will be concomitant as well. Blacks are there, but in the background, where they can be easily ignored. So let's get our TVs to be a role model for the part blacks play in society. Bring some of us out the background into the foreground. And then maybe we can work on getting some real black people on the radio.
Overbite-ridden actress who got her start in show business playing the title role in the Broadway musical Annie. And apparently, the sun never did come out tomorrow for Ms. Parker, as in this new show, she single-handedly proves out the theory that cute and adorable child stars almost always grow up to be hideous-looking, tediously annoying adult actors. Watching her screechingly nasal, irritatingly whining performance could not be a more painful experience if she were to simultaneously poke the viewer in the ear with a meat thermometer. The show opens with Parker's character watching a photo of herself pass by in an ad on the side of a New York City bus. And in that 1 5-second shot alone, I found myself wishing she was under it. You don't see overacting like that at a dinner theater in Buffalo. More mugging goes on in that show than on Bat Night at Yankee Stadium. The series is based on the book by Candace Bushnell, the social scene columnist for the New York Observer, and who was a one-time flame of Al D'Amato. Now, apparently, the gossip is that old Al is upset about the recent episode in which the Sarah Jessica character, based upon Bushnell, dates a politician whose sexual fetish happens to be, well, let's say he gets off pretending he's one of those big white deodorant cakes in a urinal. Well, if I was Al D'Amato, I'd be less upset by the water sports reference than I would be by the suggestion that somebody like him would ever have sex with somebody as excruciatingly obnoxious as Sarah Jessica Parker. She's supposed to be a dish? What kind of dish? A petri dish? I'm not one for golden showers myself, but if I ever ended up in bed with someone like her, I think I'd be the cocker spaniel and she'd be the fire hydrant. Although on somebody like that, I could very well see myself getting the urge to do more than just drain a kidney. I just don't think that even in the most bizarre realms of the world of aberrant fetishes, pooper scoopers qualify as sex toys.
How do you allow this stuff to get on the air, Charles?
I don't know, I-Man.
Well, you don't know. You're back there producing it.
There you go.
God almighty. Well, pretty amusing, but...
Well, there.
I guess that's
kind of where I was... What I was thinking about, I...
So, well, we need to fix one part of that. I'll get that done. Anyway, I'm trying to read Maureen Dowd's column on the op-ed page of the New York Times this morning during that, because...
Corner's coming up, 18 till the hour.
Rob for 12 years, and we never have any fights about anything.
Let me ask you this. Is your show a partnership?
Yeah.
Oh, it is?
Well, of course, sort of, yeah.
No, it's not. Right.
Well, yes, it is.
Is it called the Bernard McGurk Show in the morning?
Well, no, but I mean...
What's the afternoon show called?
Wait a second. Stop trying to turn it around.
I'm not trying to turn it. It's Mike and the Mad Dog. This is the Imus in the morning show.
No, but I mean, Charles and Bernard and Lou... are free to say whatever they want to say whenever they want to say it.
Oh, absolutely.
There are no restrictions on them.
Sure.
Not at all. You're right.
Well, there aren't.
Especially with your gun.
Well, no, but I mean...
No restrictions at all. Shut up.
No.
Shut up, you bald-headed geek.
No, I don't want another Time magazine column for something I didn't say. But that's fine. I mean, I love Bernard. You know that. But
I do know that, yes.
But anyway,
Hey, boss, be quiet. I'll handle this.
How was the meeting? What did they say to each other? Was there tension in the room?
A little bit, but not...
Well, there was.
Not a terrible amount. No more than usual.
What is it over? They're arguing over the Sammy Sosa should be traded from the Cubs to the Yankees?
That's the latest one, yes.
Well, and Francesa is for that or not for that?
Francesa does not want Sosa on the Yankees, feels the Yankees do not need him. Understands why Steinbrenner might want to have him on the team.
Sure.
But,
Russo, we already know, hates the Yankees.
Correct.
And he hates the Yankees, he claims, because his father would never take him to the games. But he really hates him because Francesa likes him. And Francesa, who is my friend, by the way, and I like Russo, too, by the way, but I'm much closer to Francesa. Wouldn't you agree, Charles?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Sure.
But it's not to suggest I dislike Russo.
I understand, okay, but you're closer to Francesa. Yeah, that's okay. You're allowed.
Okay. But anyway, Francesa, last year, when the Mets and Atlanta played, and that was a great series, and Atlanta finally prevailed and beat the Mets... to meet the Yankees in a World Series, Francesa was walking around the station saying, because there are a lot of Mets fans at our station in New York, because we carry them, and they are, you know, they're a New York team. Francesa was walking around the station saying, now they're going to play the Varsity.
Yep.
Well, that does not help.
Throw salt in the wound.
And that's that makes people like Eddie Scazzeri and Eric Spitz and everybody else crazy.
It's entertainment.
Then they had some ugliness over Derek Jeter and this... Alex Rodriguez, is that his name?
Yeah, a guy in Seattle, sure.
A-Rod, they call him, apparently.
Yeah.
Plays shortstop for the Seattle Mariners. And so they were called into the general manager's office yesterday for a meeting, as we've been discussing here. Well, how did the meeting end?
Meeting ended...
What did Lee say?
He said just wants to know if there's anything underlying besides, what's going on in the air. And they just argue about this stuff on the air. And it just... Sometimes it spills over and becomes, acrimonious.
So they have discussions about Derek Jeter, Sammy Sosa, and A-hole Rodriguez has affected their personal affected their personal relationship.
It's been doing it for 11 and a half for 11 years.
No, I understand that, but you would think at this point we would be past that.
Well, we're not.
Have we found that tape from yet? Well, how do they sound on the air? Somebody told me there was a lot, that there's an increased level of tension on the air.
The studio's colder than Bill and Hillary's bedroom when they're in it.
I don't think there was anything strange yesterday or anything.
Very terse.
Yeah.
Do you see them when they come in, Charles, or are you gone by the time?
No, I see them, but usually briefly because I'm writing drivel.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see them, I don't see any particular interplay.
Lou, do you see them?
They seem okay in the newsroom.
Yeah.
They're walking around as normal, but stuff has been going on in the air. Definitely, they've been yelling every day. Sammy Sosa, blah, 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 blah.
You see, I go back to...
That's what we want.
Yeah, but you say, but that's no way to live your life. Like Warren Buffett says, you know.
There you go.
If you're working with people or you're in a situation where these people make your stomach churn.
Right.
Or get out of the situation. It's life's not worth it. So that's why I don't work with people who I don't like. So, man, just get rid of them. Or get out of the situation yourself. Oh, man, do we have this tape from yesterday yet, Bernie?
We're still efforting that. We'll have Warner, it next hour.
Where's Warner? He's not in.
Right here.
Oh, yeah, right here. I'm always here for you, man.
Do you know anything about this, Warner?
No, but I would say if I can cast an opinion...
Yeah.
That's what radio's all about. That's what entertainment's all about.
Yeah, well, no, I understand.
You look at Fred Allen and Jack Benny. Supposedly they had a feud. They didn't have any feud. It made for good radio.
No, I understand. But this is genuine. That's the point.
Well, how do we know it's genuine?
It's been going on.
Well, because we do know it is. Because on the air, Bernard and Lou and Charles all wish me dead, but you know that they don't really mean that.
No, not one bit.
No, not at all.
Well, maybe this is there.
This is their way of doing it.
What do you mean, oh, no, not one bit?
Oh, no, not at all.
You hideous little shrimp.
Critically injured, maybe, but not.
I hope a mountain lion gnaws your leg off when you're out here.
Hello, darling. There are those who believe in the magic of voodoo.
Before mentioning Patrick McEnroe, good morning, Mr. McEnroe.
Good morning, Mr. Armis. Glad we could finally see you this morning.
Well?
That's one.
Hey, you heard about the big feud going on. Between Russo and Francesa.
I have heard about it, in fact.
How was it yesterday, by the way? Did anybody hear?
They had no show. Not surprisingly, they had the day off yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. That speaks volumes right there.
Yes, it does. And did we ever hear from Francesa, Bernie?
No, never.
So he's ignoring us.
But he was unavailable, that's for sure. He made himself unavailable.
This is clearly a bitter deal, so.
Mm-hmm.
Even Russo admitted that it was... Attention for high. Did you hear that one cut, McEnroe?
Let's hear that again.
In other words, you didn't hear it.
No, I did hear it, actually. But I just think I'd like to hear it again.
Oh, you would? Do you have it, Lou?
The 53-1, yeah.
Yeah. Well, listen to this.
Hi, Mike and the Mad Dog along the way, and Sterling called up, made a good point. You also got to remember that Jeter plays at Yankee Stadium, which is tough, and A-Rod plays...
But I don't think Jeter's a home run hitter, though. But I think people who just look at A-Rod's 42 homers and say it's no-brainer, I'm not knocking A-Rod. I'm just saying I think Jeter is very productive.
I would love to have Jeter on my team. He's a great, great player. I just think that A-Rod is special.
What is it that you like?
Well, look. Well, this year, you want to say that it's all injury. I mean...
Well, this is going to last year's. What is it that's... If it's not the home run, what stands out for A-Rod if it's not the home run?
All right, let me say it again.
Uh-oh.
Sunday afternoon.
Uh-oh. I don't care about one game, dog. And say it again, one game. Right, Jeter could break a game open, too. What's that? Doesn't mean anything.
Can I talk for a second?
Yeah, but who cares about one game?
Can I talk? Maybe the fans do. I don't care if you do. Maybe some of the fans do.
Maybe they do. I hope they heard it already, but go ahead.
Let's go. Let's just go to the calls. I'm not going to deal with you on that. Here's Frank on the car phone. Frank, have a...
Man, that is really ugly.
That's nasty.
That's not pretty at all.
Uh-uh. No.
Like Patty Mac and Steak Shapiro hosting a show together.
Get out the barbs.
Yeah. Man, that's attention convention. Yeah. We just don't.
Yeah.
Well, I was at the final game of the Knicks series, by the way. I was at the game when they lost to Indiana.
Good.
And Francesa and Russo were there.
Right.
Sitting next to each other. You know, I think they did the show that day from the Garden.
Right.
Hey, dog, you gonna eat all that?
And I could see them sitting where they were sitting at their little courtside seat.
Oh, yeah.
And I do not think that during the entire game that they said one word to each other.
No, they never do. No.
We'll speak on the air.
Really?
Can't they get them two seats, like different seat, a different location?
They never talk. Do they talk to each other in the newsroom, Charles?
Very little, man. I have seen some... You know, brief exchanges as they're preparing for their program or something.
Oh, can I get the rest of your fries?
Something along those lines.
That's it.
Man, that's awful. Isn't that? That's an awful way to work.
Yeah.
Oh, we love this. What can we do to make it even worse?
Probably keep talking about it.
That's what you do. Just keep dwelling
on it. Exactly what we're doing.
Keep pushing it, baby.
All right, well, here, anyway,
of sports. It's Patrick McEnroe. Good morning, Mr. McEnroe.
Well, good morning, Mr. Imus. The best game in the NBA Finals took place last night, and it may just have been the last chance for the Pacers. Reggie Miller scored 35 for Indiana, but missed a three-pointer at the buzzer as the Lakers beat the Pacers 120-118 in overtime. The Lakers now lead the series 3-1 with Game 5 Friday in Indianapolis. Now, 2 years ago, when Phil Jackson was coaching...
Will it be in Indianapolis?
Yes, it will.
Yeah, 2-3-2. Yeah.
Hello?
Oh, it is 2-3-2.
Hello? It's the finals, I-Man.
Idiot.
Oh, I hate you, McEnroe.
now I know I'm making progress.
Charles and I, in fact, my brother said to me yesterday, we're up there training horses. My brother looked at me and he said, you know, that McEnroe kid seems like a really nice kid. Is he? And I said, yes, he is. Well, he's a very nice young man. So, well, now I can tell him that you're a prick.
Oh, my God.
Wow. Very, very harsh.
No, that is harsh. Let me take this opportunity to apologize for that.
That was a little harsh.
A
little extreme.
Why don't you continue, and I'll go get some coffee. McEnroe continues.
As I was mentioning, 2 years ago when Phil Jackson was coaching the Chicago Bulls to their 6th championship, they defeated Indiana in the conference finals. Now, during that series, Reggie Miller hit a three-pointer to win the game for Indiana and tied that series at 2 apiece. Now, listen to the Laker huddle just before the final possession of last night's game as heard on the NBC microphones.
This is what they think they may run. Now, I've been here before in this situation.
Phil Jackson, that's why they call him the Zen Master, Charles. He knew exactly what was coming. Now, my question is, why go for the three when Shaq had fouled out earlier in OT? Take it to the basket, try to get fouled or tie the game, and go to double overtime. You're at home, Shaq's out of the game, you win the game in double overtime. Terrible decision.
You're the genius.
By Larry Bird there.
Yeah, not good.
As it was, Kobe Bryant, returning from his ankle injury, took over in the OT after Shaq fouled out, scoring 8 of the last 12 Laker points. Now, on the bad ankle, Bryant played 47 minutes and scored 28 points. And this kind of game, said Kobe, is what it's all about.
This is the game that I've been dreaming about, to be honest with you. I mean, I dream about it every day.
Oh, yeah.
There you go.
Hey, you know it.
How about Shaq, who finished with 36 points and 21 boards before fouling out? Was he worried when he had to leave the game?
I have a tremendous amount of confidence in my team. And, you know, this is what being on a great team is all about.
Yeah. Being a great player is what it's all about. You and Kobe dominating this series. Meanwhile, Reggie Miller says even though we're down 3-1 and have only one game left on our home court, hey, we're not dead just yet.
We've got a little bit of a pulse left in the heart, so...
Very, very little, Reggie.
Jug-eared stooge.
Well, I think Indiana will win the next game, and the Lakers will have their coronation Monday in L.A. Wouldn't that be nice, I-Man? We'll get to see all the stars come out for that.
No, it won't
Could
be
you,
nice.
I mean, you probably want the Lakers now to win more than ever, just so you don't have to see that.
That's exactly right. Want them to close it out in Indianapolis or wherever they are.
I get it over with.
As I said from the beginning of the year, rolling into June. And what's happening here, Lou?
All right, rolling into June.
Rolling into June.
I don't know, Chuck. Should I go with the Pacers now?
No, shut up. They're 12 minutes out till the hour.
Welcome to Harvard Network.
HarvardNetworkLive.com. Don't forget our dear friend, Scott the Engineer. If you want to get in touch with him, 718-BAG-5040 for his disco business. Here, he'll play music at your parties. As a special treat as I leave, here is Bon Jovi live from the other day doing their new hit single, It's My Life.
Okay. Listen to the support he gets from his band.
Well, that I agree with you. Hey, with over 50 years of... get me out of this.
92.3!
I rock.
Yeah, with over 50 years of yogurt experience, nobody knows yogurt better than Dannon. Dannon,
hey, I'm Mr. The Morning Program.
Damas y caballeros.
Ladies and gentlemen, who is the Panamanian dictator who's a sex machine to all the chicks? Me. Can you dig it? They say this cat Noriega is a bad mother. Hush your mouth. While I'm talking about Noriega, then we can dig it. Sorry, I'm feeling a little silly today. I'm in a very good mood, despite the fact that a friend of mine was supposed to fly in here with a helicopter to free my ass, and the stupid bastard landed in the wrong Florida lockup and rescued some other inmate. Dumb I'm telling you, it's stuff like that that made the dinosaurs extinct. I'm a big fan of Darwinian theory. You have to be here in the joint. Survival of the fittest is a way of life. You don't keep your head up, your eyes open, and your ass to the wall. You have your eyes down, your ass open, and your head to the wall. I think that's why our new guilty pleasure around here is watching this new CBS show, Survivor. Two teams left on some deserted island, supplied with only what they could carry in their arms, vying for a chance to win $1 million. That is, if they can survive the 39-day ordeal. And the best part is, they're not allowed to just exist. They have to compete in these games of skill. It's the real world meets Gilligan's Island meets the special f***ing Olympics. There's simply nothing better than watching Rudy, the insufferable blowhard who everybody hates, not being able to start a f***ing fire, despite the fact that he's a former Navy SEAL. Except for seeing the old lady Sonia get kicked off the island by her teammates for making them lose the raft-carrying, tribal torch-lighting, idol-worship competition. Hey, sorry, Grandma, but there's $1 million on the line here. Take your consolation prize and get the f*** out. Stop whining. You're lucky you're not an Eskimo, because a bitch your age would have had her ass stuck on a drifting ice floe 3 years ago. This is the greatest show on television. You can't take your f***ing eyes off this thing. Pampered yuppies having to trap rats to use as bait to catch fish, when you just know the toughest thing they've ever had to deal with in their lives so far is too much foam on a double latte from Starbucks. It's a soap opera with tsetse flies. And actually, if you ask me, it's a perfect metaphorical paradigm for the way you Americans elect your public officials. Like those two hideous-looking guys in New Jersey, Corsine and Florio. That proves the theory known as survival of the richest. And Giuliani, Lazio, and Hillary in New York, that's a whole nother one of Darwin's hypotheses. The one about evolution and monkeys. Jesus, talk about see no evil, hear no evil, and speak no evil.
Wake up, kids. It's 10:30. The youth ain't nothing really changing but the dates. Are you a grand slammer, but you know, Babe Ruth, you gotta learn how to relate. I've been swinging from the pearly gate. I got all the answers, and lo and behold, you got the right key, baby, but the wrong key, ho, yo.
I'm a sin in the morning.
I'm talking to a real
dang 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 ba ding dong ding dang blue moon.
University Medical Center.
Friday, Chuck.
Yeah. Here come the weekend. Here comes your bite.
Here comes the weekend, honey. What's going on? Do we put our feet up, honey? A party all night long, baby. Whatever. I'm with you. Are we staying home? Are we
thank you.
going on? Delbert McClinton.
Huh? You like Delbert Wyatt? A little Wyatt Imus here with me.
I can see that.
How are you, honey?
Holy cow.
Is this your truck?
Where's the limo, Wyatt? Come on.
Whose truck is this like?
Donnie's truck.
Huh? Is it like Donnie's truck? Want to talk into the microphone? You don't?
No.
We're not going to say any of the words we say, are we?
Oh, my God. Lou, you on delay?
Want to say hi to Chuck? Say hi, Chuck.
Hi, Wyatt.
Now's not the time to be a little dope, honey. Your mother tells everybody to speak. Can you say hi, Chuck? Wyatt.
Yeah, he's hi. Paying attention to the old man.
Say hi, Chuck. You know what, Chuck?
What?
Let me put the headphones on. You say hi to him.
Okay.
Maybe we'll talk.
All right, here we go. You ready?
Hi, hi. Wyatt. Hi, Wyatt.
Hey,
all
hey,
right,
that's
my man. How
all
are
right.
you, Wyatt?
Did you
hear him, Chuck?
Yes, I did. God,
that's
a good
guy. Want to say hi to Bernie and Lou? You like a tight T-shirt on your mommy?
Well, let's get the camera on mommy. What the heck are you talking about?
Is there any chairs over there?
No. Maybe we'll talk to mommy in a second. Want to do that?
Yeah, let's do that. Get her to say hi, Chuck.
Shut up. 13 to the hour now.
All right. Speaking of Delbert, here he is again.
You like Delbert? Delbert sucks. Don't say that.
That's mommy. Yeah,
no, no.
Pretty. Don't kiss the child. Hey,
nothing sucks.
Fire Sprinkler Association now.
Where are you going,
that
moron
in, Lou?
Face?
What?
That's you. Where are you going, moron face? Sit down there.
Well, I was trying to get the... Miss Imus and Mr. Imus. What did he just say?
I don't...
What did you say, Wyatt? Honey?
What did you just say?
No, we don't want to say that, honey.
No. Oh, my God, hit the dump button.
We can't say the BS word on the radio, honey. No.
I mean,
that is not what we want to say.
You're right, that's what this is, but you can't.
Joey Potts and Pants sitting over there. Anyway, Wyatt, how are you? Wyatt, how are you this morning, honey? How are you?
What were you going to tell Daddy?
Man, this is turning into Kathy Lee Gifford,
isn't it? Oh, my God.
This is really awful.
Please.
So, just,
that's right.
It is 8 minutes till the hour here on the Imus in the Morning program. The Lakers and the Indiana Pacers play tonight. Is that right, Warner?
That's right.
What is your prediction for that?
Tonight, the Pacers, I believe, will win tonight.
Okay, well, of course, Warner predicted...
Lakers in the... Lakers in game four.
Predicted the precise score, and that was unfortunately.
Well, it was a pick'em game, and I picked them. It was a pick'em game, and I picked the Lakers.
I have here in the studio with me a little Wyatt Imus and Deirdre Imus, and why would you suppose when's he's going to be two on July 3rd?
He thinks he's going to be four.
Do you think you're going to be four, Wyatt?
How old are you, Wyatt? Five.
No, you're not five, honey.
Five? Oh, my God.
He's a little slow out of the chute, isn't he?
You know what I used to think? I used to think that people like me, who had children and put them on the programs, should be
shot.
Yeah. What, honey? What did he say? We have to be so careful what he says, because he's just liable to say anything.
What did you want to tell Daddy? What is he?
You want to ride the horsey with Daddy today?
What is Daddy?
You are never going to be on this program again. You are banned.
You're banned for life. I'll ruin your life.
I'll ruin your life, kid. Well, how was he getting up this morning, honey?
Horrible.
He was?
Yeah.
What time did he go to bed?
10:30. He fell asleep. You read a bunch of books, right? How many books did you read?
Five.
He did read five books.
I did. Okay, well, this has been great having you guys on. We'll have to do this again.
Good Lord.
Wyatt, do you have anything to tell Chuck?
Hi, Wyatt. Want to say anything to Charles, honey?
Nope.
Hello. Hi, Wyatt. Oh, this is really...
I said Charles is goofy.
Well, he's right about that, by golly. See you guys on Monday. Bye. He's goodbye.
Juan Gonzalez and a hideous Nomo, my goodness, you certainly aren't going to get by without having to give up a lot. Well, a lot of time I don't have left, like I'm out of it. And so I want to thank you for listening and calling the whole thing. Thanks to Chris and Joan and Kyle. On the other side, you got, of course...
Sports Radio!
Shoes and coming up next on The Fan New York, it takes me a while to get things out.
Following their Game 5 win in Indianapolis, the
good old-fashioned fusion and fission. Thank you for your attention. That is all.
Right here now, the Hindu hoop.
People try to put us down.
Talking about pro-liberation.
Just because our skin is brown.
Talking about pro-liberation.
To the world we proudly say salam.
Talking
India's now got the bomb.
Talking about
nuclearization. Nuclearization, baby. Mahatma taught us how to be behave.
Talking about liberation.
But now Gandhi's spinning round in his grave.
Talking about liberation.
Ain't no transcendental meditation.
Talking about liberation.
Since we got that nuclear proliferation.
Talking about
country look just like ours.
Talking about pro-liberation.
We're no longer a third world nation.
Talking about pro-liberation.
Now we got that nuclear proliferation.
Talking about pro-liberation.
Nuclearization. Nuclearization, baby. Got a new weapon that now allows.
Talking about pro-liberation.
Us to blow up the people but not kill the cows.
Talking about pro-liberation.
We believe in goodbye to civilization.
Talking about
nuclearization. Nuclearization, baby. Something for your consideration.
Talking about nuclearization.
Dot heads with warheads, devastation.
Talking about nuclearization.
And no de facto provisualization.
Talking about nuclearization.
Gonna help you to get rid of the radiation.
Good morning.
Too long.
Too long?
No.
Is there a little shelf life involved here?
What are you a mother? We want to abuse you. Just for fun, like poking a ferret, you know.
Well, that's just right? Pulling the scab off a wound.
Right. But I need to know what you're most sensitive about so we can start there. What would you be most sensitive about?
My love for the Eye Man. And how vulnerable I feel.
The weight thing probably is not going to work, right?
Yeah, you can tell I'm really concerned about my weight. I'm really worried about the way I look.
You weigh more than Francesca now, don't you?
No, I don't.
How much do you weigh? 260.
I have no idea. I have not weighed myself.
260?
I don't know. Possibly. That's absolutely within the realm of possibility.
Do you think he weighs around 260?
He's up. He's been up. I've been.
How tall are you? On.
6 feet.
We're exactly the same height.
What do you weigh, I'm at?
I weigh 165 pounds.
You weigh 165.
But you got a bony little ass. You got a little thin little part like frame here.
Here's Mrs. Imus on a program on line 8. Good morning, Mrs. Imus.
Good morning.
Do you like my butt, honey?
I love your butt.
See?
Oh, please. Okay. I'm going to throw up.
You shut up.
Oh, my God.
You keep quiet, you bald-headed weasel.
How long did it take to iron his butt in the morning?
Honey, don't let him abuse me.
Well, Rob, Sharon likes the way you look, doesn't she?
Yes, but she has to use one of those big steam presses to iron my butt.
Yeah.
And Bernard doesn't care like the way you look.
Yes,
wait,
she does.
I'm begging you. I can't even continue on this conversation.
No. It's making him sick, honey. So how are you?
I mean, Rob's butt and the Iron Man's butt. Throw up.
How can you tell the difference between your butt and your head, Bernie?
Ooh.
Oh, man. You know, that's not necessary to attack my producer here.
What? I thought we're having like a big...
That's a good question.
That is a good question. Very good question. How long does it take? Honey.
Yeah.
What's the name of these Band-Aids that you got me for my fingers?
They're by Cure-Aid.
Yeah.
Or Cure-Aid. Is that how you say it? Cure-Aid.
I don't know. How do you spell it?
C-U-R-A-D.
Okay.
Cure-Aid Band-Aids. And they're called the extra length, extreme length, 50% longer for extra hold.
Ooh,
they're new.
Oh, they are new. It's a new product.
And instead of a single wrap Band-Aid,
right,
that's called the standard one. This is a extreme length, they call it. Wrap around twice for extra long hold.
So the problem that we have is we got Johnson & Johnson, and their Band-Aids essentially suck, don't they?
No, they just don't make an extra long one yet. They probably will respond to this challenge from Cure-Aid and come out with their own.
Where did you buy these, honey?
I bought these at the Brooks Pharmacy in Connecticut, where we are.
Oh, okay.
Southport.
Oh, okay. So.
And it says here they're distributed by Beiersdorf Incorporated in Wilton, Connecticut, and these Band-Aids are made in Germany.
Okay. AT&T became a sponsor of the horse barn out at the ranch this morning. Did you know that?
Yeah, I was listening. That's
pretty good, huh?
Yeah.
You know, we have a sponsor of the main ranch house, which Deirdre's in the process of they're doing now, right, honey? Yeah. She and the fabulous new architect we have.
Yeah.
Whatever his name is. Do you remember his name, honey?
You know, I always forget.
No, but he's one of the top 100 architects in the country. And he was recommended to us by John Silver, the ranch lawyer.
See, the guy who fell off the porch?
Yeah, and he agreed to do it for far less, well, not far less, but somewhat less than he would ordinarily charge somebody to design a house. And we already have a corporate sponsor. An individual who sponsored the main ranch house for $1 million and refuses to be identified.
Right.
But I like it when corporate sponsors, like AT&T and American Express and New York Stock Exchange and Mendicant Toothpaste and Benjamin Moore Paints and the rest of them, it helps when they do identify themselves because then it encourages other people to get involved.
Sure.
Anyway, anything else, honey?
Well, the packaging of this product contains natural rubber latex, which may cause allergic reactions.
Of these Cure-Aid Band-Aids?
Yes. Well, you know what's interesting?
Don't get dirty. What?
Well, I'm not.
Okay.
What do you mean, get dirty?
Because you know how you are, but go ahead.
I was just saying that this same caution label on this box of Band-Aids is the same caution label you would get on, I don't know, some other kind of product, maybe.
I don't understand.
Well, she sees an incongruity in the fact that this is something that has a medicinal application and that it would then, at the same time, carry a health warning in effect. I believe that's what she's saying. Is that what you're saying, dear?
Yeah, you know, like, I don't know, isn't there some company, Trojans or something?
Oh, shut up. See, that's what I'm talking about. Right away, go right for the penis joke, don't you? What's wrong with you?
I'm not into penis jokes.
You know, yeah, you are.
Married one.
What do you mean?
You better on the be. Planet. What are you talking about? Honey.
Honey.
I love you. I'll call you later.
Honey.
Yeah.
So did you decide on the belt buckle? The big one or the small one?
Oh, dear God.
This is like trying to get Bo Dietl off the phone. The conversation is over.
Blow your wife off.
Yeah, I'm going to blow my wife up here. Yes, I did decide on a belt buckle, honey.
Which one did you decide on?
The one with the... Well, I had the one on that you bought me this morning. It was one of my favorite, actually.
All right.
I have to go now.
How about, honey, what would you like for dinner tonight?
Yeah, how about that? How about, honey, what would you like for dinner? Or, you know, like, I'll have my slippers and pipe ready when I get home. I don't think so.
Anyway, honey, yeah. What would you like for dinner tonight?
I'll like you, baby. Oh, I have to go. Honey, I love you.
I love you.
What's the matter?
You're just, like, determined to make everybody sick this morning.
Well, my wife is cute. Leave her alone.
No, she is, but I mean, you know.
Yeah. She is. You're not.
That's what makes us sick.
Yeah, I hate you, Bernard. You're way too mean. You know, I'm
mean.
You know what happened? Do you notice over on the Howard Stern show that nobody ever makes fun of him?
I don't listen. I don't know.
Okay,
don't
Jackie know. Jackie the joke man, or the bucktooth weasel Gary, or the other little ass Howard Stern ass kissers they have on the program. No, they ever make fun of him.
There's a good reason for that.
Why?
They respect him.
They're feeding him lines.
And I, but why do I have to take all of this abuse from all of you?
Why not? Half of the fun on the show is making fun of the I-Man.
Here's O'Brien from Manhattan on line 3. Good morning, O'Brien.
Good morning, I-Man. How you doing?
I'm all right. How are you?
Fine, thanks. We're kind of neighbors.
Oh, we are?
Yes, we are.
Where do you live?
Up by the Dakota.
Oh, you do?
Yes.
On CPW or?
Just off.
Okay.
First Who's building.
Okay.
I can't quite afford that yet.
Fine.
We have the same hot dog lady, too.
Oh, we do?
Yes, we do.
I stopped eating hot dogs when my wife told me what happened, how the stuff stays in your colon for months. I haven't had a hot dog since then.
And the lady said that, too.
Okay.
She hasn't seen you lately.
Right.
I was wondering if I can get a ride out to Yankee Stadium on Friday.
Pardon me?
My fiance said I can head out to the game, or to the show.
Right.
But that I can't take the subway. She said if I called you and got a ride, I could head out.
I don't know. What do you think, Charles? I would agree to this. And then I would
come
Friday morning. We'd be leaving around 4:30 in the morning. That's not the time you want to leave, is it?
I'll go. Sure, no problem.
If you wear seatless leather pants
and a leather zipper mask. Right?
Come on, O'Brien.
No problem. I'll be there at 4:30.
Don't you have a job?
Actually, right now I'm interviewing.
Oh yeah,
I used to work with Steve Wynn and Harold Feldman.
Sure. Oh sure, I know them.
I used to send you all the stuff you got from Connecticut and New Jersey.
Oh, you did?
When we were doing all the development work down there.
Why aren't you with them anymore?
I left to go work for another company.
And then what happened to that gig?
I didn't want to move out to Las Vegas.
Oh, I see. So now you're out of work.
Yes, I am.
What does your fiance do?
She works down on Wall Street.
So she's paying the bills?
No, not at all.
Okay.
Not at all.
How old are you?
I'm 32.
You're 32 years old, and you want to go out to Yankee Stadium with me in the limo on Friday?
Sure. We'd have a great time.
Do you work out?
What's your sign?
I don't see a problem with this. You got a guy who's out of work.
What if he's a nut?
He wants to meet you in front of the Dakota. You getting out of the limo? Sounds like a plan to me.
Hey, I'm Eric.
What's his name? Shot John Lennon in front of the Dakota?
Yeah. Maybe.
And I have a guy who lives next to the Dakota who wants me to give him a ride in the limo out to the ballpark.
Hey, I mean, you want to sign this copy of this Hawkins Nuts? You ever read this book? It's called Catcher in the Rye. It's really great.
I don't see this happening, O'Brien.
Oh, why not? Come on.
What if you turn out to be some whack job?
Oh, I'm not. You can call Feldman. He can vouch for me.
Get his information, Bernie.
Right.
And we'll call Alan Feldman. Does he still work for Steve Wynn out there?
Yes, he does.
Okay. What's your name again?
O'Brien Murray.
O'Brien Murray.
I can see this happening.
Brad, pull up. I got to pick O'Brien up.
That guy with the squeegee. Pull up.
No, some guy that lives around the corner. It's not out of the question that I'll give him a ride. If he can't talk to me that time of morning, I don't want to talk.
No. Okay.
I have to drink my coffee and ride out in a limo.